59.
Sharada, you can switch on your video now and unmute yourself. Hi, morning.
Hi, hi, hi. Good morning, sirs.
Morning, Shailaja. What a pleasure to see you. And on behalf of the Armed Forces Veteran Officers Association, it is my pleasure, it's my privilege to welcome Shailaja. Now, may I call you Shailaja?
Please, sir. How was Doc?
Because we in the service, we say ma'am and all that. Yeah. So welcome, Shailaja.
Thank you.
I have had many opportunities to meet Shailaja. Extremely energetic, wanting to share her experience and knowledge. And I did meet her in the fashion center. And there I found she's like that Pied Piper, you know, all the students just keep following her like they would follow the Pied Piper. She organizes such interesting programs, and there are so many aspects she touches upon in our city. It's an opportunity to get to know the capacity and the capability of Shailaja. I welcome you to your talk on history of cinema, and hand you over to Wing Commander Harshavardhan, who will introduce you to our members of the AFUA. Thank you, Shailaja.
Thank you very much, sir. You've been very kind. I actually enjoyed getting to know, like Harsha sir and all, I got to know because of the ex-NCC group which Uni started. But you and Doctor are all people really enjoyed getting to know over the years through various platforms. Thank you for the opportunity. Good morning, everyone.
Morning, Shailaja. Morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to our first talk show for the year 2021. And it is number 21 in our series of talks which we initiated last year. Now, before we proceed further, I'll just give you a small introduction about Shailaja. Shailaja Chetlod is a popular media artist working across television, theater, and films, both as a performer and content creator. She is an actor, filmmaker, and entrepreneur, earnestly bonded to the development of fine arts and culture, both theoretical and visual. As an actor, her selective performances with reputed names in TV, advertisement, and stage plays have fetched her a recognition that she puts to good use in other spheres of her interest. Some of her popular performances are in Sun TV series like Rudra Veenai, Sahana, Lakshmi, Selvi, as well as Vijay TV shows, Cinema, Karam, Coffee, Ladies Club, etc., apart from her cameo in Indiran. She is the founder and managing trustee of Cinema Rendezvous Trust that runs a film club showcasing and discussing world cinemas of substance, in addition to creating awareness about cinema as a social tool. Medical and educational aid, particularly to girl children, is a priority in the trust social activities. Shailaja teaches film appreciation elective as a visiting faculty in National Institute of Fashion Technology, Chennai, and she is also an executive committee member of the Chennai International Film Festival. Her production house, Shaila Production, conceives and produces corporate films and public service announcement documentaries. She is the proprietor of Wanderlust, the travel lounge in Hotel Savera that curates heritage and temple tours. She co-promoted a contemporary art gallery, Art and Soul, promoting the visual artist with several exhibitions from 2010 to 2013. Shailaja dons several hats with her varied interest and has a contagious enthusiasm that leaves a qualitative work on all that she carefully chooses to pursue, whether in media, social work, or the arts. Shailaja completed her schooling from St. Dominic, and she graduated in botany from the Madras Christian College in 1991. Shailaja took a liking for uniform at a very young age. As a junior wing cadet, she took part in the Republic Day Parade in Delhi in 1984, when she was in class 8 and just 13 years old. I think this should be a record of sorts. Shailaja is married to Arun Kumar, who is a chartered accountant. They are blessed with two children, daughter Mritula, who has finished her MBA in entertainment from USA last year. And following her mother's footsteps, she is an actor and a producer. A son is now pursuing his course in CFA. On a personal front, I know Shailaja for over 10 years. We're like, she just mentioned, we're all part of a ex-NCC cadets group, which was formed by squad leader Unni. And many of our veteran members, like Wing Commander Sukumar, Mrs. Pramila Rajan, Mrs. Shobha Vartaman, Brigadier V.S. Subramaniam, Brigadier Mohan Thomas, Group Captain Franklin Prem Kumar. We're all members of this particular NCC group. Well, ladies and gentlemen, with that small intro, it's now over to Shailaja. The floor is all yours.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for the long, detailed introduction. Yes, for me, it's a pleasure to actually see Colonel Bhupinder Singh, whom I've met in the NIFT premises, as well as all the friends from NCC, like the most senior Subramaniam sir, everyone here. And I'm sorry, I'm a little more informal. I'm not going to be addressing everybody with their titles. What I found very interesting with this group is that when I see Harsha sir speaking, I can see his wife behind there, you know, embroidering. And how the women folk constantly, I've got to know the women folk, the families, and that aspect of the Fauj is also very interesting for me. And for people like Unni, who make all the friends to be a big family, I think that's very special. So indeed, very special for me to be talking about the history of cinema here. And usually when we go for any talks, they generally ask us to give a blurb. What are you going to talk? Will you give a blurb? I just want to mention to everybody here, because some of you may not be in the organizing committee of this year. I know this organization is as old as my career with television or cinema. I found both, it started the same year. But what is interesting is that this blurb thing, nobody asked me from your organization. And what was written there for the reminder which came in yesterday. Let me also tell you that your organization is very popular. I have got the invites, the first one, as well as yesterday's reminder from my family, from my friends, from various sources. And so I went through the reminder which went in yesterday, and what you have written about cinema, that, you know, to get to know more about it, that aspect is very nice. So I think it's very special that people whom we respect, who faced war situations, who've guarded our country. And for me, that is very, very special, because I do have family members from the Fauj. And my interest, I'm somebody who wrote AFMC but didn't clear it. So it feels very special to be here. So I'm going to start sharing. And since my talk, which will run more than 45 minutes, definitely, all the time my PowerPoint is going to be open. So if you are on the laptop, I would suggest you keep side-by-side mode, so that you can see both me and, or if you think seeing that, my daughter said, Ma, it's okay. Your PPT and your voice will engage enough. It's okay if you don't show your face. It's good to have all these inputs right from home. So yes, I am going to share it, sir. So I will be playing some videos also.
I request everybody to shut off the video, please, so that there is no lag in the videos that Shailaja will be playing for us.
Okay, so yes, it's going to be a very brief history of cinema. We're talking about a very, very young art form, just 126 years old to be exact. And because the first public screening by the Lumiere brothers was 126 years ago, but this is an art form, a medium of expression that really took the world by storm. And today, even during the COVID period, this is an industry which is having tremendous growth. It is one of the largest industries in the world today, having several arms to it. So when I speak about cinema, I'm talking about filmmaking of all kinds, though we will be concentrating on the larger screen format. But cinema, filmmaking today engulfs everything which is inclusive of the Zoom chats we are doing, and how each of us, even at 80 years, are going on exploring this visual medium. This is something which easily captures the fancy of people, especially where personalities are concerned more than the technical aspects. So, which is why it's very interesting and heartwarming that people want to get to know about the technical aspects also. And I think of all art forms, this is something which expresses, captures reality a lot more, because we may be staging it, but we are still capturing something which is really happening there, whether it is in the fiction or the non-fiction format, whether it's a documentary or we've written a story and we enact it, we are still capturing reality as close as possible in any kind of art form, compare it to a singing, a drawing, painting, or any of those things. And let me start with the origin of the word. So, kinema is a Greek word in ancient Greek, and it means basically movement. So today when we speak about cinematography, it is, cinema is actually kinema, which is movement, and graph, which is an instrument for recording. So what happened is, what was K-I-N-E-M-A, kinema, it morphed during, in French language, they replaced it with C. The sound K was replaced with C's, and people started reading it as cinema instead of kinema, kinema. So, and that way, that is how we know it, but the origin is from the Greek word. And this is something which is, I think, any medium of expression is a language. And any language develops a grammar. So there is a very strong visual grammar which has evolved over the years. But somewhere this is an art form which has a universal connect, and people relate to it very easily. So it has a lot of commercial exploitation, and it has been used through history by different people to sell different ideas. We all know how Hitler had used radio as a medium during the war. And it is during that war that cinema has also taken on a lot of interesting turns. I'm having some problem sharing. One second, give me a minute. One second, sir. I'm surprised. So usually keep doing this, but today I'm just having a problem sharing this. I had this doubt. Okay, while my daughter just tries to fix that, I'm going to continue talking. So when we speak about cinema as a movie, can you just take this and check it out? Yeah, I'm here, you can check. I'm so sorry about this. There's some problem with my laptop having got stuck suddenly.
No issues, shall you take your time? No hurry at all.
Yeah. So I just wanted to go that cinema did not start with wanting to capture motion. Because today we look at everything. When I said movement, kinema meaning movement, cinema did not start with this need to capture motion. Because simulation of motion has always existed. All of us know about flip books. We know about the thaumatrope, the zoetrope, which as children we've all gone through. I studied in a school called Christ King in Tambaram. And I remember we used to get something like a chocolate, which was a thaumatrope, a sweet thing. And we used to do flip games with that. So cinema was actually... So... We've always had the simulation of motion happening, and in a flip book kind or the zoetrope, you do see that an attempt to tell stories through these things have happened. And today's animation industry still relies so much on the zoetrope kind of the model. And so you have these vertical slots, which are actually married to an image on the other side. And as the slots keep moving, we are watching these images. So in this way, simulation of motion has always existed. But how did this whole thing of trying to capture it as cinema happened through the camera. So that actually happened in a bar. Like most interesting things happen when y'all chat with each other, have a quarrel over a glass of wine or vodka. The same thing happened with Stanford and Muybridge. Today we know Stanford University, we know Muybridge, you would have heard, we even have an institute by cinematographer P.C. Sriram and his friend, which teaches cinematography in Chennai. Muybridge, you have an institute here. So Stanford was with his friends in a bar, and then they got into an argument about the horse galloping. The whole conversation was whether the legs get carried off the ground at any point of time. And Stanford said, of course it does. During the gallop, all four legs of the horse are off the ground. And he had to prove his stand. So, which took him to Muybridge and professional photographer. We must realize that during the mid-19th century, photography was very much in vogue, though cinema had not developed. So he got in touch with Muybridge and he said, you have to capture a horse galloping so that I can prove to them. And in artistic expressions, you will notice that during a gallop, the horse's limbs were always shown as front and back, opening out like that and not together. So this was how artists had represented it in 2D format, like the rocking horse, like we have it for the children's rocking horse thing. So several organizations pitched 2Ds. Now, simultaneously in 1882, another person called Jules Marais was existing, and then he was taking pictures, 12 frames per second of the same picture. He was trying to capture motion like that, but on still images. Now, this thing had a major impact on how cinema was invented. And so you needed to have split second pictures for cinema to be shown. And so you will see that he's having something like a rifle. I have read about him, and he was considered quite a madman going on with a rifle like this, shooting stuff on his camera plate. So instead of a plate, he went on to invent a flexible photographic film strip. So originally, photographs were on plates, and then they went on to become gelatin strips, which were very flexible. And later came the cellulose-based film coating, which we've heard about, which is why gelatin is very inflammable, and which is why you would hear a lot of accidents happening then. They were very potent like that. So people were trying to capture these photographs, and initially they were very blurred images, and then they found devices to use to have continuous photographs. But you will see, and most of you being from the army or the forces, the rifle was the first thing that they all used to take the model. You will find on the right side here how they've used the sprocket and the pulling mechanism, how the film strips instead of the plate. So initially, you'll find the round circle, the exposure of light through that on the plate, which will capture the images. And then the film strips were sent across like this on a rifle-like medium. And Thomas Alva Edison, another big inventor, was very instrumental in finding one of those gadgets which captured moving film. And you will find Dixon, his lab assistant. They have several inventions to their credit, as well as several things in cinema. So cinema was not invented by just the artistic kind. It was actually a very scientific invention. So the medium kept changing. The instruments used based on the rifle were getting evolved. And it was in 1889 that the kinetograph was invented by Thomas Alva Edison. So this is one amongst several of the inventions he's done. He used to have a team to work on several of these things. So here you will see that the side we are seeing has those perforations through which light would pass. The two smaller barrels behind had the film strips unexposed there. And on either side, you had the film strips to move. They used to be pulled. And this was the first instrument, the camera, which was developed. It was called the kinetograph, which is capturing movement. This was the first time that it was captured in this way, not as individual photographs like how you saw in the horse, but movement like this. several people. There can't be one person credited to the invention of cinema. So Thomas Alva Edison invented the kinetoscope and the kinetograph. So the kinetoscope was another viewing device through which several film strips were kept inside, and there were parlors with several of these instruments next to each other. Okay, so is it something specific for me? Okay, and Harsha sir, if at any point you have to tell me something, please feel free. If any input, it's not that it becomes difficult when there's total silence.
Not at all. Continue. Okay. It's very engrossing.
Yes. Okay. So Thomas Alva Edison's kinetograph went on to capture moving images, and he put up kinetoscopes. There were parlors, these booths which people paid. There would be 10 or 15 of them in some places where people came and saw this. This was commercially very successful. Simultaneously, I told you there are several people involved in all these things, several inventions happening, and how they came together helping each other out. There was also a very healthy competition which happened. The Lumiere brothers, simultaneously in 1895, we all hear a lot about Lumiere brothers for screening, but there are several others like Thomas Alva Edison. We don't look at him with the kinetograph. We think of him with so many other inventions. But the Lumiere brothers in France were also, so there was things happening in Britain, things happening in America as well as in France. They were using, they came up with their own cinematography. So you will see the morphing of the word, the kinetograph, the becoming the cinematograph, and then it becoming just cinema. So here you needed a device to record it, and you needed a device to project what is recorded. Only this was happening. So the Lumiere brothers had another system. They were in France, and they had the cinematograph and a portable handheld projector, as you see top right and bottom left. And this was about collective viewing of cinema. So it was the Lumiere brothers who said, why should one person just look at through the kinetoscope, just one person bend over and see something? Like we see it with the bioscope man you would have seen in villages. They said it should be a collective viewing. And I think one of the most important things about cinema is that it is a big social leveler. Even during our independence or times like that, how people would sit inside a tent kotai, where caste or religion, those, I think cinema is that art form which breaks down all those things. And collective viewing of cinema is something we've been exploring so beautifully as cinema evolved. But for the first time, collective viewing was done by the Lumiere brothers in France. And the first thing they ever recorded with the cinematograph was their workers in their factory leaving, going home in the evening. And it was a very single static shot. So you had a cinematograph, which was just stationed and it filmed. And then they projected it to a small audience. There was no movement of camera at that time. It was just movement. So now we were just beginning to capture movement of subjects. Movement of the camera to tell a story comes in much later. So for the first screening, you always have to have craft as well as marketing abilities. You have to be spoken about. I think that becomes very important in art forms. Like how we talk about several South Indian artists, visual artists, painters, are not as popular or flamboyant as the North Indian counterparts or even European counterparts. That flamboyance, which many of you, I think, have in the Army, Air Force, it teaches y'all. I think that aspect becomes very important. And they had a very flamboyant screening in certain ways. 1895 it was, and you can see that they had a poster designed for it, and they had a movie ticket. So these are all restored images of those items which we've been found, because the originals of all these things are available on the net. But as I mentioned before, technical innovations were the basis of how cinema evolved as a storytelling medium. We've all, different countries come with their own tradition of storytelling, but the way of capturing motion, movement to tell stories was slowly evolved by a number of people. And we can almost say that these are some of the names who were the pioneers. There are several others. But you can see here Thomas Edison, because his invention of the kinetoscope, the kinetograph, the Lumiere brothers on the right side, who did the first screening with their cinematograph and the projection system. Edwin Porter and Dixon were both employed by Thomas Edison, and they worked with him. Porter was into exhibiting some of these clips, and he learned so much about the audience reaction to these clips that he went on to contribute a lot to the grammar of cinema in terms of editing. Dixon, again, was a cameraman who went on to find out, who went on to invent a number of cameras. George Méliès is somebody whom you just saw in the clip. We'll be seeing more in detail about him. He was the father of special effects, and what he started then, because he was basically a magician. Many of them are artists also. A magician who went on to concentrate on special effects, which today I think Spielberg or other people are still exploring special effects. Griffith, went on to develop editing and the grammar of cinema in terms of how it can be cut. So Griffith is a very important character in the history of cinema. So if we go on to George Méliès, he's the first wizard of cinema. And as I mentioned, special effects and his film in 1902. So cinema started and it was all silent film. There was no sound to it. But since he was a magician, he went on to explore fantasy stories. He made over 500 films. He was acting, financing, directing, photographing. And these are all, most of these people are such mavericks who go on, they are obsessed. You will see that even Dadasaheb Phalke, whom we will be seeing later, the father of Indian cinema, are just not bothered about what happens. The obsession takes over. Can we mute? Can one of the admins please mute from where we are having the noise? Somebody's ambient sound is coming in. Yeah.
That's okay now. Okay.
Thank you, sir. So, George Méliès, so I'm just going to concentrate. Seen the film Hugo? Can I hear you all? If any of you have seen the film Hugo?
Everybody's on mute.
Everybody's on
mute. Yes, I have. I have.
Yes, yes. That's good to hear. Because I think it's a very important film. And between Hugo and Singing in the Rain, these two films, you actually get to know so much about cinema and how sound is recorded and several of these things. When you saw this clip, you would have realized the impact that war had on cinema then, which I think is very important, as well as the different departments involved in cinema. 63 Kalaigal Union in Tamil Nadu also has so many art forms, so many unions associated with one art of cinema. Because the obvious things about cinematography, about sound design or music and makeup and stories, we all realize. But there are several smaller things. And in this clip, you would have seen the disappointment, the drive and the excitement of an artist, most of the artists in cinema. And the disappointment that a period like COVID can have on their minds. And how, so in this clip which you saw from the film Hugo, you have the character of George Méliès, played by Ben Kingsley, telling the little boy in a flashback the whole story of, because he, in reality too, he just, that chapter of his filmmaking was put away and he never wanted to speak about it. He'd set up a shop in France, in a railway station, and that's how he was living. And later on, only people come to know about this. So there are several innovators, inventors, filmmakers, even in Tamil Nadu, whom we are not aware of at all. And those days, these things were not documented properly. Most of the films, even very popular films, the film rolls, because those days, like today, it was not stored in digital formats with multiple copies in a hard drive. They required space. The National Archives at Pune has to have the temperature set at a particular temperature, a particular level, because the celluloid screen, I mean, the rolls are all kept there. So a lot of things like this. And if you see, George Méliès went on to explore fantasy as a genre, and Griffith went on to explore grandeur. And today in films also, you can classify filmmakers you see in 2020, 21 too, that these people follow this genre. The excitement for them comes from exploring further on several certain aspects. So editing, so you notice that they were just placing the camera and just recording movement. Now then, it was later people like Potter and Griffith who went on to get a grammar with editing. So what this person Potter did, who was working with Edison, he was exhibiting films. He had a lot of footage and he collected that and he went on to cut that film like how you saw that strip. Editing those days was physically cutting those celluloid strips. He cut them and pasted them together. And he said, everything need not be just, because cinema is a medium which cuts the fourth wall. So you actually move in. In any other form, your eye is the camera and you see it in one dimension. So here, for the first time in 1903, from 1896 to only in 1903, they said, okay, we can come up with different editing ways. And Griffith, when Potter does his editing techniques, Griffith goes on to talk about, we can go extreme close and shoot people. People can process this because this is the grammar of the language of cinema developing. Because you don't have to just see it the way your eye sees it, that you can actually move in, cut to a close-up of the ear, come away, move the camera, all these things developed over the years that way. So in the editing, you have jump cuts and several of these things. They went on to explore these. Father of film, in a way, is Griffith because he explored the grammar, cutting techniques, continuity editing. So when you shoot something, those of you who've done some amount, many of you are exposed to acting in several ways. Some of you have, like Unni, been featured in films because I often notice Fauj Log are very, very welcomed here because when they retire, they think they have discipline and cinema people want people with little more discipline because that lacks in the film industry a lot. So continuity editing is when you have an action, when you take it from another angle, the same thing when you do, you have to do it the same way. And in the editing table, they would cut it on action. So the hand was so far and in the next shot, the hand would move from there. That was one aspect of the grammar. And then they evolved techniques where they said, we can jump cut, we can move from here to another. People will understand. As people were consuming more and more cinema, the grammar evolved. They could take liberties. It is just like our old stories went on in a linear pattern. But today, some of the elders actually think, I mean, I don't understand the screenplay. The editing is, you're showing present. When did you go to the past? When did you come out of flashback? Because initially you had a flashback where you showed a circular thing going, or, you know, there was some gimmick done to show it is going into flashback. Today, it is all seamlessly done. So a lot of these techniques evolved. And The Birth of the Nation was one of those films in 1915 by D.W. Griffith, which explored a lot of this grammar. So even today, you will find that evolution is happening. And I find during the COVID period, so much of innovation has happened, though you may not talk about cinema as such, like we are debating whether the release of actor Vijay's Master should have 100% theater filling or 50% like before. That's one side of it. But I think there's so much innovation happening with TikTok came and then TikTok was taken off. Some other app comes and people are exploring. People are talking to recorded voices, sync dubbing, and several things happening. So many home videos, the boom of YouTube. I saw the YouTube channel of your organization. I'm sure over the years you've had so many meetings, but today you actually have a YouTube which is showcasing everything you did. And slowly we are exploring what to show, how big to keep the speaker's window, and even on Zoom, you know, what is being shared. All this is, I think, selecting, because filmmaking is about selecting what to show, what not to show. And cinema, in terms of what's happening with the OTT platforms, it's on a big boom, and the evolution has gone on strong all through the 126 years. But we just concentrate on the initial times. So the frames is a topic which might get a little too technical, but I think if you're speaking about the history of cinema, you should know about frames per second. So there is a slot through which the film is sent and light passes and it is projected. Now, how many frames in a second go through and are projected was a very important aspect. So the human eye can generally register 10 to 12 frames. Because even now when we are speaking, we are blinking. So there are these dark frames where we are not seeing what is opposite to our eye. But I think we have something called the persistence of vision, which kind of fills up. This was explored and they decided that 16 frames, not 10 to 12 frames, but 16 frames would give a smooth lifelike movement. So early films had only video being recorded, the visuals being recorded. So in the silent films, they were shooting at 16 frames per second, and they were also projecting it at 16 frames per second. But then, what is happening to sound? Because today we know everything, sound is so much part of cinema today. So initially, when they were recording stuff, they were putting text. All of you would have seen with Buster Keaton or Charlie Chaplin, there were text coming, "Once upon a time," or "and then he died," or "they lived happily ever after." They were adding text. And when the text was there, there used to be a live orchestra, which sometimes I think the Maximilian Bhavan here replicated, where an orchestra would sit where the film is being projected and they would look at the visuals and play something. So along with the text, live orchestra was playing, and then para-dubbing came in, where they would look at the film and actually speak the lines. So sometimes the actors themselves would speak or somebody else would come and speak. That was called para-dubbing. And then they went on to exploring recording sound and playing it in sync. But many times playing it in sync was getting to be a problem because the visuals would start and then you had to play the audio, which is recorded. It was becoming quite difficult. Later on, we had synchronized sound, which is one medium which married picture and sound. And then they found, so you will see on the top right, that is a close-up of the corner of a film strip. So you can see that sprocket, those holes through which the film reel is pulled. So we're still not in the digital platform. It's being recorded on film strips and being projected also through film strips. Now they started recording audio. They found that the audio can be put on the sides like this. You can see the wave format there. And during this process, which is quite technical, they found that 16 frames was not working right for them because the audio and the video were moving at different rates. So they had to slow it down, increase the frame rate. They increased it to 24 frames per second. And now all the projection systems were 16 frames per second. So what they did is they kept it at 24. They could have increased it to 30 frames per second or anything, but they decided on 24 frames for mathematical reasons, because in that way, films, the silent era films, which were recorded at 16 frames per second, could also be played, where the alternate frames were doubled. So you would see films of Charlie Chaplin, Buster Keaton, or Laurel and Hardy with that certain movement, which is like jerky movement, because those were films which are recorded in 16 frames. And with the advent of sound, we moved on to 24 frames projection and recording, and which is why these have that movement, because the 24 frames were still playing the 16 frames. Now, so we had synchronized sound from the silent era films. The first film that went on to use synchronized sound was The Jazz Singer in 1927. So the first projection, public projection, was in 1896. And you had innovations in editing and grammar, and sound actually came in 1927. So the Jazz Singer was the first film. The talkie era started. That is kind of the golden era. And initially they were like, you had Eastman color and Kodak color and several other things. You had movie tone, phonofilm, and photophone. These are all those terms which were used in terms of the companies. Today in digital projection, you have real image technologies, UFO in projection. So same way, at each period, you will find certain systems with their own typical names coming from who did it or which company was involved in it. So that was a poster for the first talkie film. the jazz singer. And what you're just going to see after this is the first time audio was heard as synchronized sound in public screening. And please see what the dialogue is. Wait a minute. You ain't heard nothing yet. He would say something. And you can see, you can imagine the excitement with which the artist would have performed this. The writer would have written this dialogue. The director would have done this. And the producer would have gone on to exhibit. You can see on the left top that poster where the theater has the screen. Talkie was happening. Now, coming to India. So that was kind of a gist of the history as it evolved world over. You saw several names who were pioneers in the invention of several scientific equipment, which had technology, which had engineering, and the evolution happened like that simultaneously in India. India has not been behind there. What was very interesting for me when I got to know this was that the first screening happened in 1895 or something, and here, just 6 months later, there was a French chemist turned camera operator, Maurice Sister. He actually brought it to Mumbai, and there was a small group of, we don't have the records of whether it was all just Europeans or they were, I'm sure there must have been Indians there, wealthy Indians there who were part of the audience. And they actually got to see Lumiere Brothers, what they showed. Some of those films were showcased here in Watson Hotel in Mumbai. So immediately cinema. Today, India is, I think, quite strong in terms of the industrial output of film production. So we had the screening earlier on also, and we've been following silent films or the first talkies quite quickly as it happened in the world stage. And in the world stage, it's important to know that what Griffith did in terms of the grandeur continues today. What Porter's things, innovations with editing are continued in several ways. And what George Méliès did in terms of the fantasy element is explored as a separate genre. All these explorations go on. In India, we have the Dada Saheb Phalke Award, which all of us know. And I'm sure most of you know that he's considered as the father of Indian cinema. Dundiraj Govind Phalke. And so he studied in JJ School of Arts. He's done photography. So he's been exploring a lot of these things. And he was, I think, employed somewhere. And he went on to see with his son the film Life of Christ, which was shot in France. In 1911, he sees this film. And just like what happened to George Méliès, he also said, I need to make films, because he was an artist, he was an entrepreneur, he was a magician, just like George Méliès. And he said, from photography, I have to move into moving images, I have to make films. And India had a very long, most of Southeast Asian countries have a long-standing tradition of performing arts, of oral storytelling. And we had puppetry. All these things have been so part of our culture and heritage. And we had so much of song and dance sequences. So India could actually move into this because stories were never a dearth. And I think a continuation of this is the song and dance sequences you see, for which India is strongly recognized. And in a way, initially, when you spoke about parallel cinema, you didn't want to have songs and dance. But today, songs and dance have become important, even with like Jai Ho or something in Hollywood. They kind of start aping some of these things we do. Good or bad is very debatable. So I think the story dictates in what way it should be handled. But our explorations in India started very early on also. But it was Saheb Phalke who went on in 1911 when he saw this. In 2 years' time, he actually goes to London, gets some equipment, comes back and takes the story of Raja Harichandra. That was the first Indian film. It was a silent film. And if those of you are interested, should even see Harichandra Chief Factory. It is a Marathi film which we showed in our film club, which was done a couple of years ago. It tells, just like I showed you Hugo with George Melies, Harichandraji Factory is the story of Dadasaheb Phalke. And you can see what kind of a maverick he was. Actually, when he saw Life of Christ, and he went on reading so much about cinema and all these things, exploring, that he almost became blind. He had cataract and he had severe problem with his eyes. But then he went on with 6 glasses, and people have helped him because he said, I need to see, I need to do these things. That's the kind of spirit with which he worked. He put in all his money, mortgage several things. He got his whole family. You can see on the right side poster. It's very interesting when you watch the film Harichandraji Factory. It shows how this whole thing of performing on stage goes on to performing for the camera. And when you perform for the camera, there are things, because as an actor, when you perform for stage, you have to do very loud things. When you perform for camera, the camera is sometimes zooming in or moving closer to you to capture you in close up. The grammar which people like Potter and Griffith evolved. So your acting has to change accordingly. So people were, actors were exploring, technicians were exploring. And what was on stage, you just capture, and then you capture, redo it again in a more closer frame, because Griffith brought in this whole idea that you can come closer and show a person like in medium shot or just a head shot. So people performed again and they recorded it and they cut from this shot to that shot. That is how editing evolved. And in 1913, we had our first silent film, Raja Harichandra. You can see this was the poster. It's a restored poster for the first film in India. That is a still from that. It is very easy for us to go into our mythologies, enact those stories. So most of our films, and when he saw The Life of Christ, it's very clearly written that Dadasaheb Phalke felt, I need to tell the stories of my gods. And that's how they moved in more into this. So Keechakavadam was the first, as I showed you, the world first, the Indian first. This was the Tamil silent first film in 1917. So 13 was Raja Harichandra, 17 was Nadraja Mudaliar. His story is much discussed if you listen to a lot of historians like Randolph Guy or Mohan Ram speak about cinema here. I performed. So the silent films were happening. You saw the first Indian silent film was 1913. The first Indian talkie film, like how the jazz singer happened, was 1931. The director was Ardeshir Irani, Alam Ara. There are several other later versions of this, but a long clip of the first version is also available. I think small clips are available on the net. Again, Bombay has been the site of several strong exhibitions, I would say. Like I recently read about how we had flights which were constructed in India much before Wright brothers have been credited, and it was done in Bombay, and same way in 1931 in Majestic Cinema. Police had to be summoned because there was such a crowd, because that was the first time cinema was having, they said, all living, breathing, 100% talking. That was the advertisement tagline. And I remember even films like, nowadays you don't have this full house running for long. I remember Kayamat Se Kayamat Tak in Chennai ran for a year or so. So same way, 8 weeks, it just ran house full. So those days, because today you have multiple prints of cinema, the technique of marketing cinema has changed today. You have multiple prints, several venues because of piracy and several things. The distributor, the exhibitor tries to make the money with multiple prints in one go. But those days, number of theaters, projection halls were less. They ran for longer time. And that's how they regained the money that they invested. So, and I think the actress in this is Zubeda, who's the daughter of one of the earliest women directors. I think she's Fatima, her daughter Zubeda was in this, and in Tamil. Some people say this is multilingual. It shouldn't be called Tamil cinema. But Kalidas was the first talking film. First Tamil and Telugu talkie. But I think it should be Tamil, Telugu and Hindi talkie. Because directed by H.M. Reddy. So what happens here is the director here, Ardeshir Irani, decides to make his assistant H.M. Reddy to direct the South Indian version of a talkie film. It was shot in the same set. And you will see that both the companies are Imperial Movie Tone. And when it was shot here, T.P. Rajalakshmi was the heroine. She was a very good singer. She comes from the stage. She spoke in Tamil. P.G. Venkatesan spoke in Telugu, the hero of the film. And L.V. Prasad was an actor in this, actually spoke Hindi. So people came and spoke their language, which was recorded. And I read somewhere that the producer wanted to know whether, it would record all languages. So he said, okay, all of you speak whatever language you want. And it was enacted like this. So there are several people who dispute that it shouldn't be called the first Tamil talkie, but it's called the first multilingual South Indian talkie, which it was in 1931 only. So you will see very quickly the same producer brought out a film in Tamil also. So that's a little about the history of cinema from the world to India to Chennai, Tamil, South India. But I added a small clip, which I don't usually do for my talks, which is the role of cinema in terms of documenting war. When I speak to an esteemed group of veterans like you all, I think this is very important. This is one of those old photographs, touched and restored, how the signal corps in Washington barracks were tutored to use the camera with the tripod. That, for me, has always been interesting. How during the World War I, cameras were deployed, army personnel were taught, or people who knew photography were commissioned so that the war is documented. I have a cousin who was involved with the Pakistan war, and I know his one of his jobs was about photographing stuff also. So this photographing and creating documents were very important, and a lot of this did happen during the war. These were some of the early cameras. We all know, everybody speaks about, so when I spoke to friends through whom I got to know most of these things, like director Naga, they all speak about Arri or the Mitchell camera, which are bigger cameras in the industry today, which are also used during the World War. But these were the smaller cameras which were evolved to be used in the war. You can just read it, the Moy and Bestie Cine camera. It is made of wood and metal, that is on the left. Then the D-Ray standard. So you can see that there were smaller cameras. Like today you have the mobile cameras as well as more DSLRs, which give you certain ease of operations, but certain features are gone. So a lot of it was evolved like this. And I know we always come up with interesting nicknames, especially in the pouch. So that was called the lunchbox. I found this camera to be quite interesting in terms of the color it has taken, the military green has come in, and how like a rifle it is, and how much easier it would be to shoot combat footage like this. So certain people were given these responsibilities. This camera had grip handles and several things like that. These were some of the later cameras used during the Second World War. I have seen Mitchell camera also, where for the war purposes, a big portion of the camera was just condensed to become smaller. Engineering technicalities were used so that it becomes smaller and less bulky for personnel to carry into the field. So each camera, like you see today, will have a good feature, but it will be offset by something else which may not work. This was a heavy camera, and I read that people would actually not use the tripod. It was too much to set up the tripod and use it. But it was used very well for shooting night bombing. So this is one of the, on the right is a Kodak model, which the Navy used a lot. So people were involved, I'm sure many of you will know this, and you'll be able to tell me about how things are documented during war and during certain other operations. Today, it has evolved into digital in so many ways, where today with cinema, our cinemas are telling us how bird kind of drones are sent and several things we've been seeing. But this was the start of all of those things. And how cinema or filmmaking was used to document wars is what we just saw. But another very important part is how war inspired the stories being told. So initially, cinema started about capturing images there, and then the language evolved to tell stories. People understood that emotions can be evoked and people can be swayed. This is a very important magical tool which made people believe in certain things. It's always been used as a propaganda mechanism. Same way, while they were filming war and footage, stories from the war inspired all genres of filmmaking. I think many of you would have seen 1917, which had a lot of technical innovations covering, telling us a war story, a drama. But some of the earliest inspirations from war towards cinema were with Chaplin's films. Shoulders Armed was the first film based on the World War. It came out in 1918, silent era films. And then most of us would know The Great Dictator. I'm just going to show you a clip from The Great Dictator for us to see. So this was comedy, drama. There have been all kinds of other genres which have been explored. And recent times have seen a major increase in the kind of stories and the genres being used to tell these stories, war stories. La La Land, the power of cinema to stir emotions in the human mind is amazing. Thank you so much. Yes.
Yes, Shailaja. Thank you very much for a very, very interesting talk. You have a real...
I'm sorry, I think my laptop was too overloaded. It was hanging twice.
No, not an issue. We didn't feel anything. Okay, but it was really interesting. You know, you really kept us engaged with all the descriptions about the movies from the olden days. Now, before I throw open the floor to the question and answer session to the others, I have a few questions from my side. Okay, the first one is like... No, first it was the movies, then it was the talkies. But still we continue to refer to as movies only and not talkies. What is the reason?
They were silent films. Movies is a name for everything. They were silent films and then they were talkies. So everything together is movies, cinema or film which we refer to. So constantly there's an overlap of all these things. But if we need to go into specific names, as it is used in film circles, the silent era, the silent films, and you have the talkie films. So even now you would hear people say, I have shot the talkie portion of my film. And then I have the song sequences to be done. So the talkie portion today actually means talking portion, the dialogue portion of a film. So they would say, I have some sequence for which I'm going somewhere. Or I have to go to Switzerland to just do the song and dancing. So these words constantly are being used in different ways, and it's just like in cinema. What is the word glamour for you? What does glamour mean to you? So, what is glamour?
Glamour is
attraction.
Attraction, right? In cinema language, kuncha glamour katinga. They would tell the heroine, kuncha glamour cutting, which means expose your skin a little more. Be more sensual. You know? So that those ways, that's exactly how a German kinema could have become cinema, or how an English word like glamour, which means certain thing in English, today in cinematic language, it means that. Or romba feeling side. So today you would, in the assistant directors would talk, kuncha feeling cutting. I mean, it's not even feeling cutting. Feel item. That is, in English language, it's grammatically wrong. But a new idiom comes in. So grammar and language is constantly evolved like that. Yes, sir. Let me read the comments also, some of them. Yeah. Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, basically today, I mean, when you see the history of cinema, there has always been the dominance by the Americans, the Hollywood. So what is it? Is it the passion, the money, or the technology?
Aren't we dictated by American dominance in several other ways also? And I think India as a nation is even taking credit for a number of other storytelling traditions slowly. We have not realized the impact our Sanskritam has had on the scientific community because we ourselves have not appreciated it. The same way I think we are still not appreciating a lot of talent. Of course, when I went to the Cannes Film Festival or various other places, I've heard people talk about, I think every culture, cinema from every country has a certain sensibility based on that culture. So our loudness, like speaking loud like V.K. Ramaswamy, or our sense of humor comes from our culture. So to understand that, we need to know the culture and ethos of that heritage. So I think just like wearing jeans is considered more modern and hip and evolved in certain ways. They'll say Mallipu babe, Davani, wearing half sari, then you're not evolved. You can stylishly wear it one day, but if you're wearing Davani every day, you're not considered to be hip and evolved. That's the American usage of, we would wear tight denims and still think that's cool, which is not suitable for our climate. I think that exists in cinema also, sir. But broadly, I would say that Hollywood cinema is more studio-based. You have more of auteur cinema coming from Europe, which is based on one person's vision. Whereas in Hollywood, the studio system, it was about the producer or the studio identifying a story, then getting the director who will only visually explore it, getting the production designer, different aspects coming together, the whole thing is put together. Whereas in certain, you can see it here also. Certain filmmakers, it is about their specific vision. They'll go on a slower pace. They will tell the story they want. When you go for bigger, grandier things, there are more people and more subjects to control. So there you lose control also. Vetrimaran in his recent interview spoke about that. Like how Asuran, the film which came, involved a lot more people, which was not usually his style of working. But I think those changes happen. Hollywood is more like that. And festivals world over like Cannes, Berlin, all of these festivals are also taking those mainstream popular cinema. Like in India also, IFFI Goa was initially about certain kind of parallel cinema only. But today the mainstream cinema is also coming into that. It's much debated, sir.
Yeah, Brigadier Shanmugaranathan has raised a hand. I think he's got a question for you.
Yes, please.
Brigadier Shanmugaranathan.
Good morning, ma'am. Scintillating talk. My question is, where can we get to see 1920s and 30s Tamil films archived? Can we access it in full frame? Some are available in YouTube, like Maya Kudrai and all that. They're very long films, three and a half hours.
Yes.
Can we get to see any of them?
So, as far as India is concerned, National Film Archive, I think they have a public library which we can know whether the film is there. And there are some film clubs or associations which do go into screening those things. In India, a lot of films have been lost because we've never documented and preserved a lot of our things, including the films which were shot then. So T.P. Rajalakshmi, whom we saw in Kalidas, she has directed 2-3 films. I think Miss Kamala was her first film which she directed. I'm not sure if those clips are really available, but I can find out more specifically through the National Films Archive, sir. A lot of these clips, what is available is somewhere there on YouTube also. And in the film festivals like IFFI Goa, which is, there is still talks about it being a hybrid festival where you will have film screening, some on digital platforms. Always they have a retrospective of certain works. So we look out, but 20s, 30s, there are not many films available, sir.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Shobha, Dr. Shobha Vartaman has got a question for you.
Yes, sir.
Shobha, ma'am.
Good afternoon, Shailaja.
Yes, Doc.
As always, it's so wonderful to hear you talk. Though it's the second time I'm hearing you talk about history of cinema, you've introduced a lot of new things in it.
Thank you.
It is enriching as as it was the last time. My question is, like, you showed some great moments in history. Maybe I'm a little dull. I haven't one particular picture, that moment you showed, was a man standing in front of a big window, and he's just standing pensively. I'd love to appreciate cinema for whatever it says. I'm sure there was a reference to context there, but if I see it just like that in a frame, what do you think I should appreciate in that frame? A man standing with an empty, dark space outside and a huge big window with his back and his hand on the window frame. Am I missing something, or it's like, you know, appreciating painting? Like, I don't know what to appreciate in that, actually.
Yeah, so that's also because this is a compilation of greatest moments in the history of cinema. I've taken it from the net, from a YouTube a person whom I just follow, that's a edit. So a lot of these films, like there's a shot from Kill Bill, there's a shot from Jurassic Park, or there's a Hitchcock shot, or there's a shot where Hitchcock can effect with the camera, where there's a combination of zoom and trolley view. So it actually rings a bell because you're connecting it with several other things. So like the American Beauty is the grandeur of that top angle shot with the beauty, with all the, it's the visual impact. So sometimes it's speaking about the emotional impact which we had in that narrative of that film. Like George Miley's, that first shot where I just mentioned the name, because after that I let you to just seep in the visuals with that music. But that shot was historically very important. So it's only to get that interest going from people who have not seen these films. You look for it and then want to watch that film, things like that. But this Hitchcockian effect shot, there are interesting things about the camera movement, or they could have been done for the first time. So you have a very... a kind of effect which stirs a very deep emotion, which makes you uneasy when you see the combination zoom and the trolley shot, which is called the vertigo effect. So this was the first time it was used, and even now that's been used. It was first used by Hitchcock, and it's been... So people break and evolve grammar like this. So there were shots where for the first time, there was a movement where it is going... the tracking shot was going. So it was going with technicalities also. When you see the whole film, you'll appreciate it.
Could have been Rear Window.
Thank you. I'm sorry, I'm so dull. I thought I'll ask this question, but...
I haven't seen all those films there too. It's interesting. And cinema has so much of technicalities which came in terms of evolving the grammar of what you shoot, how you shoot, to tell the story. Because the movement of the camera is what makes you emote with the story. And that is where the artistic creative perspective comes in, along with the scientific developments of cinema.
See, the technical things and various other song and dance, one can understand. But when you see the serious cinema, that one where it pans one hutment or one blade of grass for a long time and things like that, sometimes you sit in the theater feeling very foolish. Say, hey, am I missing something? And... is he trying to tell us a very profound philosophy which I'm not able to understand, kind of thing, you know? So I thought perhaps that window was something actually.
I think it's really okay if we don't relate to something. Ellarum super nu sonna, we can still feel it didn't mean anything.
But that's what classes you as intellect, no? Like we all want to be part of that intellect group, actually.
No, I think sometimes what happens is we are so used to, for example, there's a certain pacing of cinema which is there in Tamil or Hindi mainstream cinema. It's a fast pace. I think even in Hollywood. And then there are certain other cinemas which are slow paced. So some people don't have the interest to watch. So that, I think, is a mindset. If we can get over that mindset, try to see what it is and then decide. I don't... Like, my husband just says he does not like Bala's films. He says it's too black, hard and dark, and I don't want to see it. So there are, like, I used to think, when I saw Elipathayam as a child, I used to think, what are they? They're leaving their slipper there and they're walking on and on, and why are they showing their feet? sometimes the very same films have meant something else to me in as a young adult. Take a film like Sindhu Bhai Ravi. The whole concept of an extramarital affair or understanding what people are looking for. When I first saw it in 8th standard with my grandmother spoke about it in a very progressive way. Sometimes it happens in life and all that. It's a 9 yards mommy talking about it. I still didn't make sense. But I think at 50 today, at 20, I understood different. At 40, I understood different. So I think each of us understand it different. And it's okay if we don't see more, we don't understand modern painting. Sometimes it's not about understanding. It's just about feeling. That's all.
Thank you. Can I ask a question, please?
Okay. There's a question for you first from Colonel Bhupinder, then from Brigadier Sridharan.
I just want to thank all the comments there. I'm reading Bhupi sir's message, Shobha ma'am's message. I'm reading the comment, but I'm trying to follow here. Then I'll read the comments. Thank you. Yes.
Shailaja ma'am, first of all, thanks a lot for a wonderful presentation. Really loved it. My question is, recently you had posted that two of your courses have been approved by the Government of India. That is screenwriting and digital cinematography. That is B vocational. Are you connected with these two programs, and where are these courses going to be offered?
That is from Sendhil, sir. That is from Sendhil.
Now, you are also associated with the same course or no?
No.
Okay.
No, sir.
Sendhil
is the one, sir.
He's the only one. Okay.
Sendhil does the, for NIFT, he does the screenwriting course.
Okay.
And I do the film appreciation, sir.
Okay. So these programs, you are not associated at all with them?
In NIFT, I'm not associated, sir.
Okay. Thank you so much. Okay. But what a wonderful talk. I really loved each and every clip right from, you know, what the first one, those small papers, you know, turning them together. It took me back to my childhood, and since 1971 war, my brother had made a similar kind of a projector, and during the lights off, we used to see the same kind of a roll, moving it faster and moving it on a wide screen our camera. Thank you so much for taking us through our journey of the life and also the complete cinema, what we see today and what it was earlier. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Bhupi sir, for sharing that info with us, so I can imagine how all of you would have sat and seen it. I think all of us have fond memories of seeing those initial projections. I remember in Christ King, when I was in LKG or UKG, was the first time all the classrooms were in the auditorium. It was darkened, and then they brought the projector. And since it was a Christian institution, we had a Christian Tamil cinema. And the song, I'll never forget, Neela Kadalin Orathil. When I hear that song, even now I can smell the perspiration coming from fellow students. That's the impact of the emotion that it stirred then. And several times when we get together with parties, watching those slides or the, you know, watching just those slides and how cinema has evolved like that. I think we connect those dots very well. Thank you for sharing the excitement you heard while hearing the noise of the projector. But Colonel, you should stop calling me ma'am. Thank you.
Okay, ma'am.
May I ask a question?
You've got a question from Brigadier Sridharan. Next question. Yes, Sridharan, sir, please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you. I must compliment you.
Sir, how are you?
Ma'am, sir.
Good to see you here.
I want to, I have read a few books on Walt Disney. He's one of my favorite, and I'm sure all of us were fascinated when we were young, even now, when you see his Walt Disney's cartoons. I have read in his book that he's one of the, what do you call it, the Karta or whatever say, where he used to make for one clip of the Mickey Mouse moving, he used to make 80 drawings. No, supposing the Mickey Mouse has to jump from one place to another place, 80. And he used to patiently make with his own hand and then film it and then bring it. How does that cartoon, I mean, because in your talk, I thought he was, as per those books, which I read about his biography, he's one of the, what you call, real
behind
the animation that we talk about today. And of course, cartoon is a very favorite thing for the youngsters as well. And secondly, the way he brought the princess, various princess and other thing, which is modeled on the thing. And in your talk, I didn't hear that. I don't know where he fits in actually.
Yes.
I'll just educate myself on that.
Yes, Sridharan, sir. So by the way, are you Maitri Patsadi's relative, Sridharan?
Yes.
So you know me, I'm Shilu.
Oh.
I'm Arun's wife, Sheelu, by the way.
I know. Sorry, Sheelu. You're looking different now. I know it's so well. My apologies. My profound apologies.
Thank you. Good to see you.
I know for so many years.
The Sheelu you see at home, you don't relate to Shailaja. Who's
I see it. Maithili is different from Sheelu, what I'm seeing. Yeah, okay. Fine.
Coming to this, I didn't go into the animation aspects of it, but you would have noticed that I did mention when we did the Zoetrope and with the flip book, you can see there are multiple drawings which are flipped and multiple drawing stages, like my arm going up like this, several drawings with just this little action, which is stuck on the Zoetrope like this, which you view through the slot. Today's animation works on the same principle. Today for cinema, especially for advertisements, Hollywood cinema does work on storyboards. Indian cinema is just moving into storyboarding, but we don't go into so much details. I can send you all clips where animation films, people sit and draw each frame like that, and computerly, because of the digital era, they are moved like that. And that's how Tom and Jerry and all came with hand drawings. Now you have computerized things like that, which are moved. That is what we see as movement, which is what I showed you. It's an extension of what we saw with the flip book or the Zoetrope.
Okay.
So animation is like that. And Warner Brothers are one of those major studio systems, but most of us filmmakers tend to concentrate more on audio system of filmmaking also. But here I went into the technical innovations which went on with all this. Yes.
Thank you.
There is a question, Shalu, from the chat box from Arun Kumar. Arun Kumar has sent a question in the chat box. He says, what are the impactful trends in the near future, say the next 20 years?
It's very difficult for me to say something like that. All of us can say a few things, but what are the trends? Broadly, OTT, I think, has taken the scope of cinema in a very different way. So I think just like in YouTube, people are coming in with their own content and you have influencers. So marketing has undergone a change because you're marketing yourself. Social media like Facebook brought in a trend. And today YouTube, especially during the COVID period, has brought in another trend. Simple things like the mobile, which has 4K resolution cameras. And then you have multiple cameras, filters coming in for this. Additions of lenses coming in for this. I think all of this is really going to change the way stories are said. And personally, I think new grammar is going to be evolved because, like I was saying, the jump cut, how we understood, or non-linear storytelling narrative we understood. I think today the documentary format is going to be explored in very interesting ways, not just stories watched, written as stories, then filmed with actors. I think we are going to get into this dramatical era where if I find one of you interesting, I actually create dramatic stories from that, which need not be talking head documentaries alone. The way I explore a documentary is going to change because shooting has become less expensive, smaller, and showcasing it to people and getting appreciation has become easier with the boom of digital platforms. I think that's going to be one major change. But I think in terms of set design and the possibility of generating backgrounds to tell stories, technically, the bigger platforms, the bigger production houses will explore those things more. Yeah.
Great. Vinkaman, Ravi Shankar has got a question for you. Ravi, you can go ahead.
Yeah. Thank you, Harsha. That was an excellent presentation. And I have this question. I know our singular...
Ravi sir, can I see you?
This is one of our singular proprietary contribution of Indian cinema to the international cinema is our formula of the hero and heroine, you know, going around the trees and, you know, singing duets. Does any other country follow our formula the way we do, with the passion with which we do it at all?
I think India really stands tall in that department, but there are like other cinemas have started song and dance sequences. So the music video concept in other places has been very different. So you've had films which have a separate it's used like a BGM, like a background score, but you would have a song done for it and you would see it. And then you will hear that song in a background with other visuals here. That thing has come. But specifically what you're asking, I've seen it in some Southeast Asian films. Some of them have it, but nobody has really explored it the way we do. Our music also incorporates, like the other day I was traveling with somebody back from France and there was a filmmaker from Australia. And I was playing some of our Indian cinema music to them. And he was just saying, this is not Indian music. So he was also a musician. He was saying, okay, this is jazz. This is R&B. And he was going into all those things. And then you understand how quickly we incorporate several things. I think we Indians, in terms of all our belief systems, we quickly take in something. So our song and dance sequence appeals to a whole lot of people because we've taken their music also and visual, done these songs. And I think recently in US, we also had the vice president doing dance. So, which is, I think, Tamil Hindi songs. Bollywood, of course, leads. It's sometimes very irritating for South Indians because everybody thinks Indian cinema is just Bollywood. That is slowly changing. But I think our song and the dance sequence, which starts with our oral tradition and storytelling, continues strongly in the global arena also.
Thank you, Matt.
Yes, sir. I think
I have a question. Mrs. Mohandas.
Yes.
Mrs. Mohandas.
Yes, ma'am.
Very good afternoon, Shailaja. It was just wonderful. You took us down memory lane. And, you know, especially when I was a kid and my father was an instructor in the National Defense Academy, I've seen all those movies, you know, like The Great Dictator and Laurel Hardy and things like that. So I could really appreciate. And what I wanted to know is, you know, those days they used to have, as you mentioned, the voice over later. So now, how is the system now? I mean, now do the actors and actresses just mouth their words and they dub for it later, or is it incorporated then and there? I just wanted to clarify that.
Thank you, ma'am. So that again gave me another visual of NDA, little girl, you sitting there to watch this, because there are some very interesting film festivals and Carlo very in Europe, that's on my bucket list. It's very different from Cannes, and there the speciality is that sitting in an open air theater and watching the film festival. And for me, that goes back to army related places where I've seen. The first open air theater experience for me was, I don't remember if it was in Hyderabad or somewhere else, but it was because there were army families, army men and their families watching films. So you brought back memories of that. Coming to the way sound is explored. So when you saw the jazz singer clip there, that was the first time sound and picture were married together. It was live sound. The orchestra played inside the frame. The people spoke inside the frame and that was recorded. Mm-hmm. I would suggest you watch a film called Singing in the Rain, which will give you a lot of, it's a fictionalized story, but it will give you a lot of info about this. Coming to today's trend. So a film like Hairam, which a lot of people, very good filmmakers I know, prefer to do live sound, which is called Sing Sound, where a small transmitter with the microphone is given and it is clipped on and hidden. So even if you're a housewife, you have to, playing a housewife, like I've done, like when I worked with K. Balachandar. For television, K. Balachandar's Kavitalia and Min Bim Bangal was doing a lot of live sound recording, which limits you in certain ways because you have to speak the dialect properly. So if I were to do a Telugu film, I can't do a Telugu because I may not know all the words, or I'll go for too many retakes remembering the lines. And as an actor, if I said "Ayyo Sethitiye" or something, if I do this, you'll hear a patak, one noise, because the microphone is there. Okay. But that does happen. So there are boom mics which are placed, which will just be out of the frame. That's a very special job. The boom mic will be placed. It's recorded. Ambient sound is also recorded. Sound is recorded. So always sound is recorded when you're shooting. But only in certain conditions, that sound, original sound, is used for the final output. Films like Hairam used it. Several Hollywood films do it. But you need to have a very controlled atmosphere. I can't have a train noise going in this location if the train noise should not be there in my film. So a lot of explorations happen like that. The original sound which is recorded will be used like a pointer for redubbing. Most times we are redubbing today. And learning about sound in cinema is fascinating because there are three aspects. There are like, there is no station here, but if during my whole 1.5 hour talk, if I give you train, electric train sound at particular intervals, you can construct a geography for this location, which cinema constantly does. For example, I can give you, I'm talking, nobody's in the frame, but I can have an, and I can just look, Varen Tata, I have constructed something. I need not even say Varen Tata. And lastly, you can show that Tata is somebody I've been taking care of. You can shoot one insert of Tata. So the possibility of exploring with sound is interesting. So most of the films today, television has totally given up doing live sound. Very rarely you do because it limits your choice of actors also. Like if you have a Kajol in a Tamil film, she's not going to speak Tamil, right? So sometimes in Telugu cinema, I've heard like in films, it would be like, I actually said 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. You can dub whatever you want there. And there are tricks to the trade. There are only two. I forgot. For two alphabets, your lips come together. You shouldn't say that. You can say anything else and they will dub. So dubbing as a profession has become very strong. So a lot of films like actors like Rohini, M.S. Bhaskar, if any of you saw the Amazon story with the grandfather, the grandchild coming in, Bhaskar was a dubbing artist. And because he's a dubbing artist, he knows how to use the voice very well. There are people like Radhika in television, for example, who will always dub for herself because you know her voice so well. But there are others who will just come, act and go because there are others who will particularly not go for dubbing even if they have a good voice because they don't get paid for dubbing. Oh. So it's okay. I acted. You get somebody to dub. It's not my problem. But there are other kind of actors like who feel, no, it's my voice and I'm identified with my voice. So many times for me, because when I did Rudraveena and all, I look so different in person and in the roles I do. Many times they're very docile, nice roles, which I'm not in real life. So what happens is I like, and people identify me with my voice. So I like to use my voice at all times. So different systems, but most times the location sound is recorded. And then it is reworked on with dubbing, where you're sync dubbing, like that.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Thanks. Thank you. It's good to see that view. So you have a camera up there. See how much we can get to know each other by looking at how their cameras are placed. And I can almost say who set it up for you, who all lives in the household. The advantage of Zoom.
It's just the two of us. It's just the two of us. Thank you. Thank you. I think once the pandemic is over, we'll invite you home too.
Yes, thank you. I'm waiting to come to Tambaram and see the Vardhmans and everybody.
Most welcome.
Shailaja, I have one small question for you.
Yes, ma'am.
Why do the filmmakers always tell the story wrong? For instance, that Kaatru Veliyidai, the Air Force officer was shown as a very arrogant, uncouth chap who treats his woman bad and things like that. Don't they do their research and do things like that? And why do they have to show things? And invariably, they show military officers as, ruffians and in a negative manner. Why?
I get it. I have this friend, Naga, who's always worried about, he will always say, cinema la rank, I mean, he's a civilian, he's not even been an NCC cadet, but he'll say, enna rank potirukanga, ultava irukku, police officer ku wrong, military officer ku wrong. He often goes on to say, the stars are wrong, the bands are wrong and all that. So one thing is technical errors, another thing is portrayal of character. So I agree that... in Indian cinema, we do not go on to research properly sometimes, which I think is also filmmaker specific. There are people who really go on to concentrate. Everything is time and money. So you need to have a costumer who knows about this. You need to have a costumer who has the budget to get the right kind of khaki, whether it is the ceremonial attire or all those details come in. But coming to characters, what is right and wrong in life. As an artist, I think I do not want to define what is right and wrong. It is for people to explore. And I have understood that there is typecasting, which is just like, just because I spoke a certain kind of dialect in Tamil and I had fair skin, and half the time when I'm not animated, I look very pavam. So I was given only pavam housewives who will be a doormat. So that is typecasting. And when I got successful in two roles like that, all the roles I got were like that. And then I needed somebody who will give me a role like Rudra Veenai, which brought in a certain mystery and strength. Then immediately I'm getting five roles which are like that. So there is a lot of boxing which happens, not just in media, but in real life also. So we think military officer, police officer, toppe irukadu, because we expect that they will do physical activity. But in reality, it could be different. I think the same.
One particular thing is, Shilu, the way they portray it, especially these guys, all these heroes and all that in the military uniform with beard, you will see none of us would have been with the whiskers. You will see any officer in this particular clip. You will not see anyone who is not shaved today. So,
yes. I really understand that, because those regarding the cut and those things are one aspect. But ma'am was asking something very important about portrayal, about character sketch, about the character arc which is presented here. I think it is one way of looking at it. And are all army people, are all officers same in terms of mind? I think if I have a chartered accountant husband, he could be very progressive, giving me space. There could be another chartered accountant.
Shailaja, I'm sorry. I'm going to stop you here. It's not about individual personalities.
Yes, ma'am.
It's how they behave in a mess. In that Kartru Velidai, that Air Force pilot, he ticks off his wife in front of everybody, wife or girlfriend or whoever it is.
Yeah.
Nobody treat, there is a code of conduct and there is a etiquette and behavior. And whether you are a horrible monster at home or not, we don't know. There may be incidences. But you're portraying a different tradition, etiquette, and conduct to the general public who think that, hey, the military karam, patalatan, that kind of a thing is wrong portrayal.
I also understand that there will be etiquette in terms of mess behavior where the other officers, I mean, I perfectly understand that. We've had so much of debate about this. And beyond all this, I think there is a responsibility India is waking up to in terms of how we portray people who work for the country, whether it's doctors or policemen or military, because this goes on to influence the way people look at it. Like making all politicians a butt of your jokes, or all police people who won't be straight, or all military men that they're ruffians. I really understand it, because I think that is where the responsibility of a filmmaker comes in also, where you have a responsibility to say it is this character in private space, that character's personal trait is this. But in certain conditions, this is how they behave. So I think I agree with what you say in terms of having the responsibility to portray things as they are in terms of uniforms, haircuts, looks, as well as mental behavior, I think is very important. Which we don't do even for the women characters, ma'am. Doc, you will find that women don't think for... One of the reasons I stopped acting 10 years ago was I was not getting roles which were even remotely close to the real me. I always had to be somebody who would never think or only take care of, talk of children and husband. So there is a disconnect, ma'am. I agree to that.
Isn't some of this within the purview of the censor board, Shailaja?
Sushi, good to see you here. Sushi is part of my film club too. So, Sushi, these are conversations we should be having stronger there, right?
Yeah. No. I'm only carrying on from where Mrs. Vartaman, left off.
So, coming to the censor board, there are so many interests. So, censor board, again, you will find creative people fighting a whole lot of things. Where there is some truth in having that flexibility, but so if there are rules, then you are coming down on individual expressionism. So all these are very debatable, but there are no rules majorly in terms of how you can portray these things. It belongs to that set of people who sit to see the film for the censor certificate. So there are no, it's not part of the written set of rules, Sushi, in terms of do not portray military or the armed forces people in this light. That has not come in. But with more awareness and people asking for rights, if there is more activism on this, I think all these modifications do come in, I should tell both the ladies there.
No, no, it's not, do not portray them like this. That means when you say, put a rule like that, that means it is happening, but you don't do it. But what I'm trying to say is, I'm yet to see an officer behave that badly in a mess in all my 40 years of being in service with my husband, actually.
Yeah.
And the other thing is, it doesn't happen in the Hollywood movies. Like I've seen the big, Top Gun and other things, but they don't do it the way we do it.
In fact, we've had
the message for you to take to your cinema.
Yes, excellent cinema in Hollywood, which portrays, brings in a lot of respect for the armed forces or any of the officials working for the nation. That happens more in Hollywood films. Here it doesn't.
I'm just to give you a live example here. Just before I asked the question a little while ago, I think Colonel Bhupinder Singh asked a question and he said, please don't address me as ma'am. Now, it was very difficult for me to start a question without addressing you as ma'am. I left Air Force 23 years back, but the armed forces has not left me really. So that is how the, you know, the strong indoctrination it is. So to portray some people as rude, just because they're wearing the uniform here, it's certainly not going with the times after all.
Yes, I think this has been represented to Mani sir in a number of ways.
Okay. Shiloji?
I do see it because I see it even with, with Unni, I know, like he's out of it. I still know I've noticed how the body goes, how people come to attention with friends like Bharat Singh or all of y'all. I've noticed that. And even with somebody like Sridharan, whom I know as a family man, I would have seen him in his veshti and angostram. There's still that something about the force which stays. Like even NCC stayed with me, sir. Yes, Sridharan.
You're talking about the armed forces and that, you know, the best film I can think of is The Patton, which was made in Hollywood. But the advisor for Patton is none other than his own boss, Omar Bradley. Okay. But when we make movies here, I don't think we take that much of advice from the armed forces.
There are some people who really take an effort. Like if you've seen the movie called Pukar, I don't know how many of them have seen it. The Anil Kapoor.
Major Ravi in it.
Major Ravi was the advisor for them. So they did a very good job in terms of the portrayal of the military. They did a good job. Of course, they had to make it. They had to make the cinematic movie song and all that happen. But the movie by itself, the military portions of it, they did quite a good job of it. So.
Yeah, so it depends on the filmmaker. And several times I know that advices from big people have taken and not followed because they feel artistically something else works for their market.
Okay, Shalaja, thank you very much. It's been a very, very interesting morning. And I think your question answer session was also as engrossing as your talk. And I sincerely thank you for having taken your time off today to be with us. And it's close to 2 hours and 5 minutes that you've been talking. And time has just gone by.
That's really long.
That's okay. We enjoyed it. And I think it's a Sunday morning well spent for all of us. So on behalf of everybody, I wish to thank you for having shared your time to be with us this morning. And look forward to seeing you personally whenever Unni organizes the next meeting.
Okay. Oh, he has started already.
Yeah, okay. That I was not in town that time. I'd gone to Bombay, so I couldn't make it for the 24th Wala meeting. Okay.
I would be very interested if there's something related to the forces where some of us can come. I think that's very interesting for us because we are always interested in knowing something more about life there. And I would specifically like to invite some of my filmmaker friends for an interaction. Yeah, I've been thinking because NIFT group went, some other friends have gone to OTA. I think filmmakers have to be generally taken to see the passing out parade or understand a little more about all this. I think then Dr. Shobha and Sushi's concern about the portrayal gets better with all these things. And thanks to all the comments I see on the chat. It's been a lovely morning for me, a very attentive, interested audience also. Thank you very much.
And now I request President M. Arshil Vartaman to kindly say a few words and wind up this talk show, sir. Over to you, sir. Kindly unmute yourself.
What a brilliant morning, Shailaja. Fascinating presentation. And, you know, we hear so many learning lessons. So there are we enjoyed cinema all these years, but we never knew what really goes on and how it evolved and what is the kind of work that goes behind producing cinema. Brilliant presentation, Shailaja. And the way you handled the question answer session was, you know, fantastic. I think you answered everything so pertinently and so well and clarified it. Though I have all these military guys, I'm telling you, they will always say you're portraying wrong. Okay. But all said and done, I thought you did it very beautifully. We owe you a treat and we look forward to welcoming you once we are all able to meet in any of the forums other than virtually. We look forward to welcoming you.